So we're gonna, you're gonna give us 5 minutes. Yes, 10:30. And then she said she wants to be done at 10:00, so she goes over.
I see.
Okay.
So double branch. Jump on over.
Yes.
Of the volunteer.
Or I can. It's 11. Yeah. Hello. Thank you for coming to What Can We Do to Protect Animals Overseas? My name is Jessie Brockway and I'm a 2L at Lewis and Clark Law School. We have two speakers today, Kathy Hessler and Natasha Dolezal. Kathy Hessler is the clinical professor of law at Lewis and Clark. She is the first and only faculty member hired to teach animal law full-time in a law school. She has been teaching animal law since 2001, and animal law concepts as part of nonviolence class offerings beginning in 1989. At Lewis and Clark, she is the faculty advisor to Salvif. She coaches the animal law moot court teams, and she is the advisor to the animal law review since 1998. Natasha Dolezal is the director of the world's first and only animal law LLM program. At Lewis and Clark, she teaches and works within the Kenya Legal Project. She is the former state prosecutor, government lobbyist, and legislative assistant. She has prior experience in wildlife conservation in Kenya and the U.S. And she spent important time among many golden retrievers while working at a nonprofit. And before I get started, thank you all for coming. We want to focus a little bit of time to provide context of how we're going to be speaking during the presentation about how to help animals overseas. And we're going to do this first by providing you some background about the Kenya Legal Project. The Kenya Legal Project was something that started at the Center for Animal Law Studies in 2012. And why we chose Kenya was basically because we were asked. And then the next step was trying to decide, should we say yes or not? As part of our mission to educate the next generation of animal lawyers, we feel that it's a disservice if we don't prepare the next generation of lawyers to deal with global problems. And create an animal attorney who can go beyond borders to help animals. So we said yes. And in that vein, we did have some existing connections. Kathy was a colleague with a primatologist who approached her about work in Kenya that she was doing, recognizing that it would be helpful to have lawyers there. It would be helpful for students to see what was going on in Kenya and to introduce animal law to Kenya. For me, I had been in Kenya 15 years prior doing wildlife management as a student. And it was during that time that I decided to go to law school. So we wanted to go back. And we took a couple trips there over the course of that year planning. And we learned about, even though you all knew, we knew about the poaching crisis. Elephants will be gone if the rates of poaching...
6 years.
Sorry, 6 years, yeah. In 6 years if they continue at the rates that they're going now. The political and social climate in Kenya, they had a new constitution in 2010, one that is seen as pretty progressive. They elected a new president, and over the course of the last year, with the international pressure and the climate in Kenya, they were really focused on wildlife conservation and revising their Wildlife Conservation and Management Act. During the course of investigating whether or not we were going to take the class or start the program and work in Kenya, they did revise their Wildlife Conservation and Management Act and change it. And a little bit of background, Kenya has no sport hunting there. We also wanted to try to see if there were ways in which we in the U.S. could learn from Kenya and what they're doing there. They've had a long tradition of no sport hunting since the 70s. We also were able to get grant funding that allowed us to make that trip, make multiple trips. And choosing Kenya, it was a nicer fit because they have a common law tradition, And we knew our students could participate right away because everything is in English. And so it was a natural fit for us. And over the course of those first two trips to Kenya, we decided to, these are going to move, right? Create a project that had three different components. And this is just one approach to how we can help animals overseas. And it speaks to what we think are our strengths, which number one is teaching and our students. And so the first goal was to provide an educational opportunity for students, not only at Lewis and Clark. We opened it up to students internationally and at law schools throughout the country, as well as attorneys could apply. And from what we were told, that this course that we taught last May was the very first animal law course taught in Kenya, and we believe to be the very first animal law course taught in Africa. The second component was to create an international professional exchange for Kenyan attorneys. While we were there, I was able to go to a judicial dialogue, the first of its kind, where sitting around the table you had judges, you had prosecutors, you had Kenya Wildlife Service, you had Border Patrol, you had Customs Agents, you had the Tourism Board, and they were sitting there with all the NGOs. And it was the first time everyone in the room was talking about this problem. There was the U.S. Embassy, and then there was me from a U.S. law school, and Joyce Tischler was there from ALDF. When I got up to speak, I realized that what I could offer in that group of experts who knew way more about this issue from their perspective was the animal law perspective. And it was something that they had never really considered. They know about environmental law, but they didn't realize that animal law was a thing. And I brought our brochures, I brought our law review. So afterwards, a lot of judges and prosecutors came up to me wanting to know more, wanting to come to the United States and be trained. And so we decided to add that as another component. Third, we visited law schools and vet schools and engaged them in trying to assist their efforts there to establish more animal law in their existing schools and as part of their curriculum. And so that leads me to the introduction to this program. We're going to focus on Kenya and China. And I think that the link between ivory is easy. You can't have a conversation about elephant poaching in China or in Kenya without talking about the Chinese influence. And this summer in Barcelona, I listened to a presentation on China from two animal law experts, Amanda Whitford and Deborah Cal, about Chinese animal law, that there is none, and they focus mostly on dogs. And so I saw that overlap and that link between what was going on in Kenya and what was going on in China. So we want to focus on dogs in Kenya, dogs in China, and elephants. So beginning with elephants, this is a picture of Satao. And some of you may have read about this in the news. Here he is with his family in Tsavo East National Park. And Tsavo East is the closest national park to Mombasa, which is the biggest port that is exporting illegally ivory out of Africa. And he was killed by poachers by two poison arrows in May while we were actually there with students. So this was all in the news. And his tusks, there are less than 12 of these great tuskers that are in Tsavo. South Africa had the Magnificent Seven, and they've lost all theirs. His tusks were 6 feet long, 100 pounds. And the man who took this photograph spent days and days in a box to try to capture the image, because what he thinks is this elephant got so good at hiding himself in the brush. And when he finally saw him, he saw him weaving in and out of the brush, but he would always keep his tusks hidden. And so this elephant's death happened in 2014, despite all of the media and the attention and the government's actions. And it's emblematic of the problem that's still going on, even amidst all these changes. He technically was supposed to be guarded by KWS Rangers 24/7. And this still happened. So whether or not they were actually doing it, whether or not they were corrupt KWS Rangers, we're not sure. But that was what was supposed to happen. And he still was lost. So the legal challenges in Kenya, you're going to see a reoccurring theme for both Kenya and China. Existing law, enforcement issues, technical capacity and training, and then what's going on within the governments. And like I said before, we focused a lot about the changes in regard to the revisions to the Wildlife Conservation and Management Act. We learned that this was just prior to the new act. The old act, poachers would go in, plead guilty, pay a fine, and then they'd be out the next day. It did not act as a deterrent effect at all. And so when they were revising it, they really focused on trying to up the penalties, trying to sort of stem the tide of these poachers, getting them put in jail, having no bail relief. And what's happened is that they've increased the penalties, but now there's a flip side problem of the penalties are a mandatory minimum of about a $230,000 fine or life imprisonment for poaching an elephant. And one example I just wanted to provide was that you had this very old law that wasn't working. So from about 2008, when the poaching started to increase, to 2013, Wildlife Direct did a scoping survey study of courts, and about only 4% of poachers went to jail. And this was the same thing. They would just pay a fine and they would get out. In 2013, the smuggler had about 500 pieces of worked ivory. He paid about a $100 fine. And then he could be taken back to Nairobi National Park. There's no elephants there, but a nearby park the very same day. And another aspect of that Management Act, it created some changes within the enforcement. And so I mentioned before that the Constitution of Kenya had been revised in 2010, and that really focused a lot on judicial reform. And we were able to speak with judges. And what's going on in Kenya in terms of that is they want to help. They want to work on this problem, but they're facing other resources and other constraints. They have a 6-year backlog of cases. We were told that 8% of cases in Kenya settle. So if you're charged for something, you can hedge your bets that your case isn't going to be heard for maybe 6 years. They're pushing these wildlife cases faster because of pressure, but when you're up against, you know, the judges, it's the same thing we hear here with animal cases. You stack up the cases of wildlife or animals against, you know, crimes against humans like rape and murder and robberies, and your resources are so strapped that that's what you deal with first. And with these mandatory minimums that they've now enacted with the new law, it's a lot of money in Kenya. $250,000 hurts the poacher who's gone out and done this work. So does life in prison. So they're not pleading. And the judges, if they go to trial, are raising the burden of the prosecutors to really have a tighter case because the penalties are so much higher. And this is new for them. And we heard from judges that they don't have an evidentiary storage system. Some of the judges were storing some of the evidence in their courtrooms. So evidence just disappears. And in wildlife cases, the evidence is usually physical. And either it was alive or it's something tangible that you need to establish. And they don't have that capacity. And another thing is the enforcement mechanism in the Kenya Wildlife Service. As you can see, they have 975 rangers and they need about 2,000. In the U.S., we have about 200 fish and wildlife agents, and the Drug Enforcement Agency, the DEA, has about 2,000. So even here, there's just a disparity in what's considered important, whether, you know, being a Kategos ranger versus a police officer is more prestigious, or Kategos is seen as a second-tier job. But they have 31 natural reserves, 8 sanctuaries, and 57% of this wildlife lives outside the parks. They're not living in the conservancies or this, they're moving around. And I was there 15 years ago, and going back, The only thing that has really changed is that the Chinese have invested in Kenya, so the roads are better. And everyone has a cell phone, and that's good. But the population has just spread. And so these animals are coming up against conflict all the time. And within the KWS, there were prosecutors, only three of them, who were assigned to cover all of these wildlife cases. And so they could only cover 18 of the courts, and they had to make a decision to cover 18 of the courts that were located in poaching hotspots. But there was still poaching going on in other courts. They just couldn't do it. And another big problem for them is they can't tie the tusk to the elephant. They don't have any forensic capacity in Kenya. They were shipping all of this stuff out. They have no in-house experts to come and testify that will say this is an elephant tusk. They've done DNA testing to prove that. KWS did get grant money to have a lab there. A German company, Qiagen, just gave them a DNA extractor, but they have no one there in Kenya who knows how to work a DNA extractor, so they're still training them. But that is helpful. One other thing about, I lost my train of thought on the extractor. They're having issues with, when I mentioned the KWS, a new study was just commissioned by the government to investigate the KWS. And a lot of senior level officials were laid off or put on leave while they saw that, because the outcome of the study was the corruption was rampant. 50% of their vehicles were not deployed for protection. So an agency I already mentioned, Wildlife Direct, was pleased that the study came out because that was what was suspected was going on within the KWS. The prosecutors, it's positive, but they need a lot of bodies. They have 170 prosecutors for the state. They need 1,200. When we were there in May, 100 new prosecutors were going to be trained. They still need more training for the 35 prosecutors that will be in the Wildlife Crimes Unit, but they've created one. And another outcome of that study that I mentioned before with the KWS reaffirmed that 70% of these cases involving poaching, the files were misplaced. And they don't have an electronic database, they don't have anything, it's just a file in a room, and it's easy to make it disappear. Again, the prosecutors are dealing with no forensics. They can't process any evidence, so they have evidentiary issues from storage to just maintaining the chain of custody. They are having difficulties with these stronger penalties in the new cases and trying to prove their cases in court with the burden being raised. And one thing that they don't allow digital images in court as evidence, so they really are a little restricted in what they can do with such limited resources. They can't even just take digital pictures of the evidence and admit that. But they are making progress and they are being trained. So, and it's within Kenya. And the US government in the form of the embassy is assisting in that. And some other additional obstacles are this lack of animal law or environmental law perspective. They just don't think about it. I mean, they think of environmental law, but that field isn't even really established in Kenya yet. Like I mentioned before, their technical capacity, without having a lab, without having experts, without even being able to store it. Ivory is worth more on the street than gold. So if you can buy ivory for $50 a kilogram and sell it for $2,100 a kilogram, it's really appealing to Kenyans who need to make money. And again, to government officials who have that. And it's a sad story and it's hard to really get into the details of it, but with that kind of a problem, it's hard to make inroads. And again, you have this Chinese investment in Kenya's infrastructure, which they're investing in everything. They're there. They made the roads. They made it easy to move the ivory, to move across the country. And you also have the public's distrust and lack of confidence in law enforcement. We were there and we were told the number one agency or form of, who does the public distrust the most in Kenya? And we all kind of guessed, but it's the police. And I've been there enough and been with friends there enough that say, if I get stopped, I should just pay the bribe. So that's still going on, and it creates quite an obstacle. And lastly, this is just a great picture. We've gone and took the students to the David Sheldrick Wildlife Trust. And I think it's important not only to see Kenyans, all these elephants, they live with their keepers for 2 years, and they rehabilitate them and send them back out. But right now, they're orphaned because of poachers. They're at capacity because of poachers. And these elephants are being killed at a faster rate than they're being born. So they're doing important and great work, and it's helpful to be reminded of why we're doing the work that we're doing. And so before we move on to China, as you can see, it's the same kinds of themes that are problems, the existing law enforcement, government support and demand, and lack of public awareness. I put this picture up because I'd never seen an ivory carver before, and I hadn't thought maybe of you have not seen one. But it's a Beijing ivory carving factory. I found this from a gentleman who's gone in and tried to really photograph and interview these ivory carvers. And so in China, you have a lack of any legal framework protecting animals. They don't have an animal law perspective because they don't have any laws around animals. Ivory is legal there from a government registered dealer, but you know there's issues with black market ivory and counterfeit ivory, and now people are going to Siberia and digging up 1,000-year-old mammoth ivory and working on that. So there's just a lot of issues with enforcing anything. I'm sure everyone knows about CITES allowing China and Japan to purchase some stockpiled ivory as their attempt to control the slaughter of elephants. But I would argue that wasn't really effective, but everyone can debate that or not. And you also have, what's stunning is that you have 150 legal government-licensed ivory shops. And even though at the same time they are trying to allow organizations like IFAW and Animals Asia in there to try to do public campaigns to stop poaching, they're building new ivory factories. And in fact, they're also starting an ivory carving degree program at their universities. So they're talking out of both sides of their mouths. And ivory has become a profitable, secure investment for folks. So they're cracking down, and when people keep starting to talk about how there's going to be a ban or everyone should be a ban, that causes people to try to just buy and stockpile more ivory because they think it's not going to be around. So it's just really ramped up the slaughter of these elephants. And with half, it's getting better, but half the Chinese survey thought that ivory just came from, it was just farmed. The elephants just lost the ivory, like you lose a tooth and a new one can grow. And that was natural. They don't think there's a supply problem with ivory at all. And I put this up at the end because it's been successful in that IFAW has done a survey that people, once they see this, they change their minds, they didn't know. But basically it says, "Mom, I have teeth," and it talks about this relationship between a young elephant and his mom, and that the tusks are actually permanent, and once you lose them, they're gone forever. And that an animal has to die in order to get the ivory. And I think that it's positive, but at the same time, like I said, they're doing this while they're starting new programs in ivory carving at their universities, while they're building new factories to carve ivory. Kathy will talk about the positive things that are going on. So Natasha had the unenviable task of talking about the problems.
And so she's going to set up the problems, and I'm going to try and talk about attempted solutions, and we're going to do the same thing on the issue of dogs. So as you can tell from what she said, there's even way more to talk about. Every sort of sentence she said, we could have spent 15 minutes talking about. So we're trying to give you a sense of what's going on in really quick terms because it informs our work. And as she said at the beginning, we think it's really important for students and for animal advocates to understand the global impact of the work that we're doing. It's becoming more and more of an issue. Not just we live in a global world in general terms, but in very, very specific terms. Something that's happening in China is killing the elephants in Kenya. And we have to understand many aspects of the problem in order to be able to do anything about it. And so what Natasha was able to outline was there are the legal consequences and the legal structures we have to deal with. There's sort of the political and pragmatic structures, and then there's social issues. And that's the same thing we're seeing repeated in every issue where we're beginning to investigate globally what's going on. So this is just kind of a fun plaque that links the visit of the premier from China to Kenya. And this, again, is sort of puffery, if you will. Yes, we care about these things. Yes, we want to come and talk about it. Yes, we're going to sort of reaffirm our commitment to protecting the elephants. So what's actually happening? So in Kenya. So as Natasha suggested, we have a lot of legal changes in Kenya. The legal framework is changing. So Kenya is a really interesting country in Africa. They position themselves, they think of themselves as one of the leading republics, if you will, one of the countries that actually follows the rule of law better than some of their the other countries in Africa. And they see themselves as what starts in Kenya can spread to the rest of Africa in a positive way. So it's interesting to work with folks who see themselves that way and who are trying to make that a reality and yet struggling with some cultural, traditional resource and other kinds of constraints. So, and then the other thing that we just, as an overlay, right, everything, every step forward, you have to worry about, right, how, what's the reaction going to be, and is this really going to be a step forward, or is it really going to be two steps back? What's the reaction to the step forward going to be? And so the folks in Kenya have worked really hard on the amendments that Natasha suggested in getting increased penalties, because the penalties were ridiculous, right? And nobody was taking it seriously. So they said, absolutely, we have to have these strong, strong penalties, and they're going to be mandatory minimums, right, as opposed to these maximums, sort of a different way that than we handle it. But we've had these additional problems. So it's great. That has been a statement from the state, right, that this is a serious problem. So that is a positive social statement. It's a positive legal change, right, that these kinds of crimes are actual crimes and we need to take them seriously. But as Natasha suggested, there are sort of a repercussions from that. Judges don't like mandatory minimums, and they are therefore not wanting to sentence some of these folks. Some of the Kenyan wildlife conservation officers have been killed in the field because now that there are serious penalties, folks don't want to get caught. So it's ramping up the violence in the field. So there's a lot of additional problems that we're seeing from that. And as we speak, the folks in Kenya are working on new additions to their law. Right? And so the thing that's really fascinating is to be working with people who are thinking about it in a structural, legal way and being at that moment in time when we can say, okay, this is how we do it in the U.S. and this is stuff that may or may not help. And that's part of what the clinic is doing. And we can talk about that later. But to be in a moment in time when people really are recognizing this is a crisis. Right? In 6 years, they'll be gone. All gone. All the elephants, all the rhinos in Africa. Gone. Right? And so people are like, whoa, even if you don't care about the elephants, we care about the economic impact because tourism in Kenya is 25% of their GDP, right? So there's lots of reasons to care about this. So the increased penalties is something they're working on. They're going to try and make that work even better. The additional prosecutors from 3 to 35 within a space of a year. Think about that. And we're talking about 3 for the country, okay? The entire country. So from 3 to 35, they're going to try and get that up. And these folks are also getting training, which is nice. Lawyer prosecutors, a lot of the prosecutors, they have police prosecutors. It's a system in Kenya that's part of, a lot of countries have it. It's not what we're used to. So police can arrest you and then prosecute you. So think about that, right? And think about that when we're talking about ivory. So no legal training, an incentive maybe, right, for bribery or for some of that ivory to go missing. So lawyer prosecutors, there's a new emphasis on having lawyers being prosecutors, which is very helpful. The judiciary, basically what happened after the new constitution in 2010 is they said, all right, all the judges in the country at every level, except the Supreme Court, every level, you're gone, you're out, theoretically, right? And you have to reapply for your jobs. Because now we're going to actually do an assessment about whether you're fully trained and whether you're corrupt and that sort of thing. And so about 35 judges weren't reappointed. They're now suing, so who knows what's going to happen. But that meant there was room for 35 new judges. And those judges got trained, as well as some of the other judges, into these new ideas, this new system, this stronger rule of law. So theoretically, that's going to be very helpful for the system. And then, as Natasha discussed, these coordinated efforts, which is the first of its kind in Africa, and it's very helpful. And community education. So as Natasha said, we're having these animal community conflicts, right? The elephants are trampling crops or destroying other things or getting in the way, and it's not just elephants, it's wildlife in general. So when you have people who are living in poverty, we have to take very seriously the concerns that they have. How do we manage those two very real conflicts? We want to help the people, we want to help the animals when they're in conflict, what do we do? So one of the things that folks are doing really well and have been for a number of years in Kenya is trying to involve the community to help them understand what their stake is in the wildlife and maintaining the wildlife. Not just, again, in theoretical terms, but in concrete economic terms or other terms. And I'll talk about that a little bit more in a second. So speaking specifically about the enforcement, so this is one of the KWS officers. When we took the students in May, one of the things we did was a desnaring day. So we went out into land that's not allowed to be hunted, and we're looking for snares, and there's this campaign that one of our NGO colleagues had set up, this desnaring campaign. And so what happens is people just take wire, right, and they make these handmade snares and they set them out, and then it's mostly for bush meat, right? And the bush meat trade is huge right now in Kenya. And so they're passing off zebra or, you know, all these different kinds of animals as beef, right? And it's being sold in restaurants and grocery stores. So, and then after they use it once, they can reuse it and they can go back out and just, so it's a really, really cheap, efficient way to get a lot of money really fast. So part of the goal is to go out onto these lands and pull up the snares and take them away so they can't be used, so they can't kill one animal or maybe many, many animals. And in fact, then another NGO or another part of the NGO sculpts these wire snares into art and then sells them for the community. And that's one of these kind of community building projects. So this was one of our KWS guides, not really, it's like security, right? So this guy has an AK-47, right? And that was our day in the field with him. It was kind of really nice to have him. It was kind of really scary to meet him. And we did come across one dead animal. It was really, really sad, but it brought home for the students how important the work was. And we got 10 snares, so that part was a good day. So the forensic capacity Natasha's already talked about, it's really just a resource thing, right? So when we got there, they said, okay, we don't have the capacity, so any case, right, that has a forensic component, what they've been doing is sending that information to the museum in Nairobi. Again, from anywhere in the country, there was one facility to do the forensic testing. So you can imagine the backlog. And we have judges who are, again, trying to take their jobs really seriously and saying, all right, if this is a bushmeat case, I've got something that's dead that's been sold as cow. You're telling me it's not cow. How do you prove that? Well, first of all, where does that, you know, dead animal get stored, and how do you take the tissue samples, and how do you prove that it's a zebra and not a cow, right? So then you have to prove it's a zebra to prove that a crime was committed, right? And that's not even talking about ivory. And then when we get to talking about ivory, is this like antique ivory? Is this from the stores that were released? Is this, you know, what kind of ivory? Is this, you know, mastodon ivory? Or is this even completely counterfeit? So the forensic capacity is really important. So now there's this big, beautiful lab, and when we were there was nothing in it. Now there's at least one machine in it, and hopefully people will be trained to be able to use it. But again, that's for the entire country, right, they're trying to manage. Border security, because of the geographic location of Kenya, right, so it sits on the ocean, and there are many other countries where illegal ivory activity is going on, and Kenya is a transit country. So what they're beginning to pay much more attention to, which they didn't for a while, is not just what's happening in Kenya, but what's traveling through Kenya. So as Natasha mentioned, the Port of Mombasa is one of the biggest ports bred export of illegal ivory to anywhere else in the world. And people are being exceedingly creative in how they're getting this stuff out of the country through the airports, through the trains, and to the ships. And so they're beginning to step up border security. They didn't even have, like, you know, x-ray machines for some of these train terminals. So they're beginning to do that. And then focusing on foreign involvement. So the Kenyan government has a really difficult position, right? Somewhat of a schizophrenic relationship. So they really need foreign investment. And some of that's really helping their country. So the roads are horrible. And we need good roads in Kenya. But good roads mean foreign investment. And that brings a lot of foreign workers. And that brings different ethics and ideas about how to interact with the wildlife. It also means much easier access to the animals. So if we hadn't talked about this with our students, they'd be like, yay, we can go on these nice, smooth, clean roads, brand new roads to get closer to the animals because we want to go see the elephants in the wild. Great, so that's really helpful for you. It's also really helpful for the poachers, right? And it's really helpful for getting this stuff in and out of the country. So there's a lot of double-edged sword to all of the initiatives that people are trying to engage in. And that's why, Natasha, we're not expert in all this. We need to rely on the folks in the country, right? Their experience and people who've been doing this work for decades to help us understand where we can fit in and where we can help them do what they're trying to do. So the technical capacity, we talked about that. So the training is really important. Natasha is on this judicial dialogue and helping talk about how we do training in the U.S. and how training and who we train and when we train is sort of a consistent cycle of training straight from everyone who has any contact in the entire legal system, right from the police on up. So they're developing that now in Kenya, which is wonderful. So I'm going to just re-emphasize something that Natasha said. So the sport hunting is illegal in Kenya. Right? That is not the U.S. system. But it's important, right? And it's an important part of the economy in Kenya. Other African countries have decided it's important to have sport hunting. Right? So there's this really interesting dialogue about how you save the wildlife and how you conserve it and how you manage those resources. But each year, well, every couple of years, there's an effort to reintroduce sport hunting, which has been gone since the mid-60s. And some of that is U.S.-sponsored, okay? So the Saudis, apparently, and the U.S. hunters really want to get into Kenya and open up sport hunting. So again, this is really globalized, right? It's not just the Kenyans aren't actually asking, and there's an overwhelming objection on the part of the Kenyan people for sport hunting, which is what defeats it. Animal welfare is now being incorporated in schools, and that's a really phenomenal thing. So we're able to go and talk about animal law as a construct, and that's a really nice thing, but that's useful at the higher levels, right? At the law schools, at the vet schools, with the police, the prosecutors, right? The government officials. But at the middle schools, the elementary schools, talking about not animal law, but animal welfare. What are our duties to the animals that are around us? And starting those conversations is a really important thing, and that's happening, and it's being very successful. Developing, maintaining, and managing conservancies and sanctuaries, that's an ongoing conversation. There's lots of different ways people hold land, hold title to land, hold the right to manage land in Kenya. Very different rules for each of these different systems, and what does that mean for the animals within those systems, right? We know from the U.S. there are sanctuaries that are sanctuaries, right? They're not really there for the animals. They're there for the entertainment of the tourists and making money. And so trying to avoid those kinds of problems and have real conservancy, real conservation going on, real protection. And then government corruption and public distrust. Natasha already mentioned some of the things that are happening to try to overcome that. The First Lady of Kenya has joined this campaign, and that's been really good because the last First Lady was actually implicated in illegal ivory. So that's a nice shift, right? So even if it's not 100% true, right, these social shifts are really, really important statements. Natasha mentioned the crackdown. And I've talked a little bit about the education. One of the conservancies we did visit has some of the funding that they get, actually, they fund a local school. So the community actually recognizes that the welfare of their children's education depends on the management and the success of that conservation area. And so tying those things together more tightly like that is helping. It's beginning to pay off. China. So what are they doing to control illegal ivory? Not as much, okay, not a surprise. So In the legal sense, they're not doing anything. They did officially reiterate support for the 1989 ban. So this is, these pictures are seized ivory. So they, remember, got permission to sell a whole bunch of ivory recently, right? Relatively recently, it sort of opened up the markets again. And then there's been a lot of backlash, so now they said, okay, we're gonna destroy some of this illegal ivory. So this is a big celebration and demonstration of what they're gonna do. So, I don't know if I can move the little pointer. Yeah, so those are the machines that are gonna crush the ivory, right? Here's all the officials and the beautiful display of ivory. This is the same from a different angle, and I wanted you to notice that this is written in Chinese, and I don't know whether it's Mandarin or Cantonese, and English, right? So think about why it's written in English. Right, this is not just for domestic consumption. This is trying to send a message to the world, hey, we care about this, we're gonna play this game, right? We're gonna be good international partners with you in this. Remains to be seen how much they're willing to do. China does have an interesting history of wildlife conservation. So they, like many other countries, went to like, let's kill them all, right? For a long time, and let's hunt them all, and let's trophies. And then when the pandas were about gone, they actually shifted, and there was a national effort to try and save the pandas, and there was a lot of controversy about how they're doing that, but they've at least shifted their thinking about that maintaining pandas is a better thing than killing all the pandas. And so if we can tap into that philosophy, right, if we can say, hey, that was something of a success, let's try and do that with the elephants in Africa and your involvement with it, then we have some leverage, we have some ways to have a conversation and find some common ground. So people are trying to do that. So this is a poster from one of the social campaigns, and as Natasha said, there was a survey that 70% of the folks in China thought that ivory just fell off, right? It was like teeth coming out, it just fell off, or they were farmed and it was humanely harvested, right? There were no harm to the animals. They had no idea. So now people are showing them pictures of, you know, elephants' faces hacked off for the ivory and how it actually gets harvested. And so this is part of that campaign, right? That taking the ivory actually hurts the elephants, it kills the elephants, it causes harm. And when you tell people that, right, that they don't want to be part of causing harm. And so then we have to talk about overcoming some strong and long-standing traditions of using ivory. So that's part of the reason for the use of the celebrities, so Yao Ming and Jackie Chan and some of those other folks, right? And there's been some success with the shark finning, right, in China. And so the Chinese government is also telling its citizens, when you go to Africa, please don't pick up ivory. We'll see how that works. But the corruption and the campaigns actually work together. So the Chinese government said to its officials, we don't want you to be seen as corrupt, so you will not be spending money on shark fin soup at banquets any longer, because that's an excess, right? It's consumption that makes the common people upset with us. So we're not going to do it anymore. Shark fin consumption dropped within like a month, 40%. Okay? That changed the price of shark fin, so it poisoned. And so that means it's not so profitable for people to go and do it, right? And it's continuing a decline. And then people are also having sort of the social and moral conversation about what this is and why it's bad for the sharks, for the environment, and so forth. So if the Chinese government is willing to make a statement about ivory, right, on the same terms, we can have sort of an overnight impact if they're willing to do that. We're not there yet, but we do have the capacity to have that happen. This is Yao Ming. In one of the ads. And so one of the things we also want to mention is the U.S., right? So one of the things that we do in our work is we don't want to come and say, hey, we're the experts and we're going to tell you what to do in Kenya, right? We want to know what people want to know from us. We want to stay within our area of expertise and figure out how we can be helpful. We also want to change the problems in the U.S. We want to change and highlight what is the U.S. involvement and complicity, right, with these things, and figure out how we can change that. So, from the problem side, there's a statistic that's often used. Studies are often cited that say the U.S. is the second highest nation consuming ivory. It's not actually true. It took us, we couldn't find sites for this, we couldn't find support for it. We kept hearing it over and over, and finally when we were at a meeting at the U.S. Embassy in Nairobi, one of the, we had the whole like conversation about this is how, this is where it came from and this is why it's wrong. So basically, if you count item by item, so like each trinket, each bracelet, that's where the number came from. But if you're talking about sort of metric tons, we're not at all. So it's China and many other Asian countries and then the US. But it doesn't mean we're still not a player on the consumption side, right? So we have, these are sort of what we allow. So we allow ivory in if it's a sport hunting trophy, if it came in prior to the 89 ban, or if it was acquired before the 78 ESA listing, or if it's over 100 years old. Okay, so now we've just talked a little bit about the forensic difficulty in Kenya. Think about the forensic difficulty in the US. How are you gonna figure out whether this ivory is antique, is over 100 years old? Right, so if you're an officer at the border of states or you know coming into the US, how do you decide how to comply right, with this stuff? If you've got a piece of jewelry coming in, is it even ivory? So we have significant problems at our own borders. So hunting and the push for hunting and the push for trophies puts pressure on Kenya, on the government, and on the populations of elephants across Africa. The US also pushes some other policies that hurt the habitat and wildlife in Kenya in particular. So we're pushing to have more CAFOs in Kenya. And we're pushing the use of pesticides, right? Our USDA and our US Fish and Wildlife Services think these are really good mechanisms by which to do business. And because we think they're good, we want to export them to the rest of the world. And by the way, some of our major companies are maybe funding some of that work. So we are involved in making it a little bit harder for the elephants in Africa, and we need to be aware of that so we can talk to our own folks. So what are we doing in the US to try and solve the problem? So Obama signed his executive order last summer, in July of 2013, basically saying this is, we're gonna protect wildlife, and he pledged $10 million to do it and started a task force, and he actually did it right away, which is nice. We have two state bans right now, New York and New Jersey. We have other ones pending, potentially also here in Oregon. We also destroyed 6 tons of ivory. We do have the ESA, and we do participate obviously in CITES. We have the African Elephant Conservation Act, the Asian Elephant Conservation Act, and we have actually done a lot with seizures. So there's a lot going on in the US to try to protect the elephants across the world. Not enough. All right, so one of the reasons we want it, so that's elephants. Okay, right? And as you can see, there's a lot to talk about. We could stand here and talk to you for a lot longer about the elephants. But we want to give you a juxtaposition. So wildlife is important, but companion issues are also important. And so we're going to use dogs as an example to be thinking about the companion animal issues. And again, look at Kenya and look at China and then a little bit at the US. Sort of to talk about this is how we're doing our work, how we're looking at these issues abroad and in the US. And to help you understand why, well, you'll see sort of some of the conversation, but China is, you know, huge, and numbers matter. So just like we care a lot about factory farming because the numbers matter, anything China does matters, right? So their actions or inactions with respect to dogs end up mattering because we're talking about huge and significant numbers. Natasha has the, again, unenviable task to tell you about the challenges.
Yeah. But before I begin, just to add to what Kathy said, I often hear Professor Frosch talk about dogs as the gateway animal into getting people to think about animal welfare and why they should care. And so for Kenya, elephants seem to be that animal. Because we got in to talk to so many folks about elephants, we then were able to talk about animal cruelty laws in Kenya and dogs. And so again, the same themes, existing law enforcement and then other sort of specific problems that they're facing. In Kenya, they actually do have Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act, CAP 360. We talked about that a lot when we were there, and most people didn't know they had it. And we're talking about prosecutors, law enforcement, and judges. And so that's a problem. This law was enacted pre Kenyan independence, and it was revised in 83. It does address cruelty and control of animals in experiments and animal fighting and cruel slaughtering and hawking of animals. And again, like in the Wildlife Act, the fines are very low. So they range depending on what you're charged with, what element, between $5 to $35, 3 to 6 months. But again, no one's being prosecuted for cruelty cases in Kenya. But it does allow for all of these things. It doesn't really have a minimum standard of care or any kind of negligence in the statute, but it does address prevention. And again, they are trying to review it and change it, but I don't know where they're at with that process. So again, with enforcement, a lack of awareness about the crimes, lack of sensitization among law enforcement about why they should be important. Here, again, we talked a lot of it about the link when we were there. When we did have Kenyan magistrates here, they took a course in the summer about the link between violence against animals and violence against humans. It's intuitive. They know it, but they were happy to see it and that we take it seriously here. Like I mentioned before, we have resource issues with law enforcement and capacity. The same evidentiary issues apply. Police aren't trained on how to collect and preserve evidence. Same issues with the wildlife cases. Vets are not trained to report. We visited a veterinary school. Students who were very, very interested in animal welfare. They formed their own little group. That was really inspiring, but they had no idea they had a role that they could play in a law enforcement of cruelty. And so we were there to answer their questions about how we use veterinary science in criminal cases. And again, with the corruption in the police department, I'll just give you one example that we learned about when we were there. So a baby calf was buried alive by a group of people as a ritual to try to ward off a curse that had been left on someone's family prior to his death. So a baby calf was born alive, 6 months old. An animal organization brought a charge under the Cat 360 case, and the case went to trial. Five individuals were charged. They were all acquitted. And the reasoning behind it varied. The court stated that, on the plus side, they didn't throw the case out. They heard the whole case. The court stated that the prosecutor didn't have enough evidence to link the actual burial of the calf to the people who were charged. But not that it didn't count, not that they weren't going to think about it. So from the prosecutor's side, they were happy that the case even made it, and it made the news. Others criticized the case because, and threw out the reason, well, you didn't prove that it was a calf. What if it was a buffalo? So it pointed out that when we were speaking to the vets, someone needs to be in court to just establish these sort of baseline elements that you need to prove if you're going to actually go to court on some of these things, and so that the vets have a very important role to play. And additional obstacles, again, are Kenyans primarily use dogs for protection or guarding or livestock. We can see a rise in, you know, real companions where they're bringing them indoors within the cities, but in the rural countryside, that's what they're used for. So on the plus side, they do have a Kenya Society for the Protection of and Care of Animals. But from what I can find, it's kind of the only one that's really working on domestic animals. But when they say domestic, they mean donkeys and pigs. So your average Kenyan has contact with a lot of animals, but they just have a different relationship with them. But an interesting thing that has just started to develop is dog breeding. It's being marketed as a career. And to have a successful kennel and start to really breed intensively German Shepherds and Rottweilers and other large guard dog type breeds. And something that you'll commonly see in Nairobi, I couldn't get a good photo, but are these puppy hawkers. And they'll come. You can buy anything in your car when you're stuck in traffic in Nairobi, and bunnies and livestock and dogs. And the dogs will come up to you, and they're, most people know not to buy them, I think. I would like to think so, because they're clearly drugged. They're sick, they have parvo, distemper. And again, that's technically illegal under Cat 360, but it's people are doing it in broad daylight, and it goes unenforced. And so, getting to China. And I think for China, again, I will quote Pam, it's the gateway dog, or the gateway animal here, to get people to start to think about animal law issues. This poster went viral. This is about the Yulin Dog Meat Festival that I'm sure you all heard about in the news, and now it's kind of just ubiquitous for how dogs are treated in China. And it's the same thing. Again, there is no cruelty statute in China. So there's nothing you can do for any of these animals when they're treated that way. In 2009, there was draft language submitted to the government. As I mentioned before, in Barcelona, we heard two experts on Chinese animal law talk about this legislation, and that it was, you know, it was pretty good. There was a lot in there about minimum standard of care, negligence, even offering rewards to people who would call in animal cruelty. But it's just sat there, and nothing has happened. And now it was submitted in 2011, and it was amended quite a bit, and all you're kind of left with is a prevention of cruelty after the act has already happened. Nothing that is trying to protect the animal from it ever occurring. So in 2014, we're still waiting for something. But there is nothing. There was, Amanda Whitford said she was hopeful because when she was at a conference in 2014 on the dog meat festivals, that people were talking about actually having a ban. And that is something that wasn't spoken about before. There was some proposed legislation imposing a fine for eating dog meat and cat meat, but that is still pending. And so one example is that in China, when there was a dog being pulled behind a car on a chain, and that's legal, and people just took photos of it and posted it on the Twitter equivalent in China, and there was public outcry. And all that happened was the gentleman goes on the news and makes an apology and says his dog was biting people, so he just wanted to try to get rid of it. But that's all that happens. In the same case, there was another case about a college student putting a dog in a microwave and people finding out about that. But all that's done is, you know, public outcry. The person is ashamed. They either have to move away, they have to make a public apology. But there's no actual law in place. Interesting. The other obstacles is to focus just on Beijing and dogs. You've got government-sanctioned killing and abuse under these dog management squads. Dogs, in the time of Mao, were seen as kind of culturally elitist, a Western thing. So there were no dogs. Dogs were banned in Beijing. And they began to loosen that in the 80s and even more in the 90s. And in 2003, people in Beijing could own dogs. They could own any dogs. And it became the third largest pet market. So there was a rapid increase, 35% growth in pet ownership. But somewhere in 2013, Beijing had an outbreak of rabies. And they attributed that to dogs that were taller than 14 inches. And they banned dogs that were taller than 14 inches and 40 different dog breeds. So my golden retriever and my great Dane are banned. People were forced to, if they were walking on the street, their dog could be seized, beaten in front of them. Even if they had a license, it wasn't the right license. There's a thick instruction book on how to register your dog in Beijing. And to get a license, it's more than it is in Portland, which is $40, but it's $180 to $250 in Beijing. In order to have a dog. And you're only allowed one dog per household. You can register another dog, but this is one of the things I mentioned. There's vague regulations. So one dog per household, but the government encourages if you have a golden retriever, go register that at some other household beyond the city of Beijing. But the public is confused on whether or not then they can bring their dog into Beijing to go to the vet, or if they happen to run into law enforcement, will their dog be seized? If it's seized, it's typically sold into the meat trading business. And there are more than 100 animal welfare groups in China. It's growing. It's completely driven by the public, and they're helping work on these issues. 200 activists stopped a truck full of dogs and paid $17,000 to get these dogs out of this truck where they were going to be slaughtered. But what happens is they have nothing in place, no infrastructure in place to then deal with the 2,000 dogs that they've now paid $17,000 for. I think it's wonderful, but they just don't have the capacity now to really care for these animals. And I'm in this one. Let me make sure. Okay. Yep. Try to cheer us up a little bit. I will try. So as Natasha said, one of the things, us being there to talk about elephants gave us the opportunity to talk about other animals and have conversations with people in Kenya about anti-cruelty more broadly. And it was a great privilege for us. So as she said, CAP 360 is their anti-cruelty act that is being amended. There was some momentum on it, but there's basically one attorney that we know in Kenya who we work with who was pushing it, and there's been so much going on with the wildlife issues right now, it's taken a bit of a back burner. One thing to know is that in China, in Kenya, when the government wants to do something, it can happen almost overnight. It can happen really rapidly. It's not like the U.S. in that way. So we're hopeful that there will be some movement, but we recognize the dire situation that the elephants and rhinos are facing. So Natasha also mentioned the legal training for vets. So our lecture a year ago, was the first conversation that any vet, there's only three vet schools in Kenya, that any vets had to talk about their legal responsibilities. And what we tried to help them understand was their legal responsibilities happen in two contexts. And again, this was not a conversation anyone had ever had with any vets in the schools. And that is, one, when you're talking to your clients, right, the people who bring you the animals, you have to explain to them what their duty of care is, right? There's a legal obligation to maintain these animals so it's such that it's not abuse or neglect. People don't know what that is. Literally, they don't know what the standard is. They don't know the law exists, so they don't know how to comply with it. And so vets are sort of the great venue, right, to have those conversations. And that they had not just the right to talk to their clients about that, but really they had a veterinary duty to do that. And then to prepare any case, any work that they did, that they should be working up sort of in a standard way, basic facts, basic information about if they thought the case might go to court, right? So this animal came in at this day, at this weight, in this condition. Here's my expert sort of opinion about what I thought caused that condition. Here are the tests I did, right? And putting all that into a chart so that it could be submitted and testified about in court. Again, that's not something that anyone had ever talked to them about. Now, it looks like an entire course is going to be implemented, hopefully this coming year, at least at the vet school in Nairobi, to do just that. So we're delighted about that. Rabid dogs are a problem in Kenya as well. So as Natasha said, dogs in China and in Kenya are, we don't have the same relationship with them that we have here in the U.S. It's evolved. So they have an older relationship more like what we used to have. So they're used for things, right, for guarding or for other purposes. But the companion animal construct is growing. And so dog ownership is growing. And there's stray dogs, and there's wild dogs, and there are owned dogs. And there are rabies outbreaks. And so in Kenya, what happens, they just go and say, all right, all the dogs in this like district, we're going to kill them, right? Because we don't want the spread of rabies. And people are generally speaking down with that because they don't want to get sick either, and they don't have any medical resources for the humans, much less for the animals. There's a law that actually requires when you're going to euthanize dogs to use strychnine, which is, many of you may know, a really horrible way to kill dogs, to kill animals. And it was actually built into the law. So again, this is one of the opportunities we were able to talk with the vets and say, okay, so we understand that in some instances you may decide you want to euthanize a dog who's got rabies and then maybe not the whole community, but you shouldn't have mandated in the law an outmoded version of that euthanasia. So that's an easy legal fix that they're working on right now. And by the way, let's talk about prevention. And so the group that we work with, Africa Network for Animal Welfare, has already been, they have vaccination clinics, and they have been working to increase shelter capacity in Kenya. So Kenya's a little bit ahead of where China is. So this picture is of one of those types of clinics where these kids came with the dogs for care.
So there is increased support for veterinarians. There's increased understanding that the vets need to get out into the communities and talk with people. And there are these vaccination and sterilization clinics to do preventive kind of work. And this is a picture of one of those. There's also increased training for some of the local community officials to help them understand, because they just literally, some of them don't know what the medical realities are around transmission. And so this is a picture of some of what's been going on in the community. So this is Washira Kiriuki. He's the attorney that I was talking about that we work with in Kenya. And he's trying to push the companion animal issues as well as the wildlife issues. And so he came to this, it was Animal Day that they had. And this is Tabitha Wainia, and she's the vet for that organization. And they only have one lawyer and they have one vet. And so she's actually doing a training. And then this was a day people could bring their dogs to get washed. And that was a whole thing, right? So they need to be washed, they need to be groomed, they need to be vaccinated, and there's conversations about sterilization. And so they basically bring this sort of resource to the community, community by community, and say, we've got these services, bring your animals. And then they see people playing with the animals in a really positive way, and they can model positive interaction. So there is more going on in Kenya, and people love their animals in their own way, right? And just in the same way that we do. And so once resources are made available, the treatment increases, which is great. China's a little bit of a different story. So IFAW's, and so NGOs, again, there's really, on different issues. Sometimes there's a lot of NGOs working in these countries on these issues, and sometimes there's not. So then IFAW's been working in Kenya on dog issues for a while. So they are trying to stop these dog culls, and you know, it made the news here. They came in 5,000 dogs, right, all at once, going to be killed. So they're stopping these dog culls, and they're trying to deal with the Beijing regulations. And just to emphasize what Natasha had said, so before 1980, dogs were illegal in cities. Just couldn't have them. It wasn't just Beijing, it was any city in China. Right? And we've gone from that to there's an estimate of over 250 million dogs in China as companions, right? Not in the food industry yet. But Beijing is sort of the go-to, right? So their regulations are sort of multifaceted and trying to figure out what actually makes sense. So in some respects, I'd kind of rather there weren't dogs, right, being owned until people can own them properly. So on the one hand, I kind of like the registration fee, right, and that it's high and that not everybody does it, but given that there's corruption, and given what happens, right, if you don't have the right thing, there are these stories, right, people actually beating the dog to death in front of you. This is an illegal dog, the dog's dying, that's how we're killing the dog. That's outrageous, obviously, right? So thinking about reducing the fees and incentivizing positive behavior is something that they've been working on. This is a group, Together for Animals. They have the Anti-Cruelty Granny Squad, which is kind of cool, right? And so they're basically trying to rescue animals and they're trying to provide shelter, and then they're trying to rehome them because there's too many dogs, right, based on this, the cost and the available resources. So they're rehoming them to the U.S., interestingly. So we've already talked about this a little bit. The one is called the One Pet Policy instead of the One Child Policy in China. And it's interesting because there's a lot of social issues. So some people are thinking because of the one child policy, because kids don't have siblings, they're actually gravitating towards animals. And because of the increased affluence in China, and now people can have companion animals. And that gives people exposure to animals and have that develop a new relationship with animals. And that's what helped in the U.S. for people to begin to say, oh, they're actually beings. They actually are sentient. They can be harmed. I actually care about that. So the fact that what Natasha said about the people who saw this truck of dogs going by, and they just literally stopped the truck, right? So these were young people, and then they paid out of pocket to try and save these dogs. That's phenomenal activism in China, right? Because that's risky, and it's not organized. And so it's an indication, I think, of the new generation of Chinese folks, right, who have some exposure to these animals, have the room to care about them, and so we'll see what happens. So there has been work to reduce the dog meat trade, reduce dog meat festivals. And one thing just to say, we try to be super sensitive about cultural imperialism, right? So if there's a tradition, we step really lightly around that. We want to learn about it. And we're not the ones to tell people to stop. People in that culture are the ones to address that. But one of the things we did discover is that dog meat festivals and dog meat eating is not culturally traditional throughout China. It's just sort of one part of China. But part of it's actually growing, right? So this Dog and Meat Festival is moving beyond its traditional boundaries. But there's sort of other cultural imperatives in China too that can counteract that narrative. So Buddhism, Taoism, Confucianism talks about, you know, harmony, and it talks about animals, and it talks about the well-being of all. So that's something that folks are beginning to use. Really quickly, in the US, so we're importing these ideas of breeding. And so breeding both in Kenya and in China is taking off, and that's, they're using our model. So that's not something that's helpful for us to share. We tend to still purchase products with dog fur, and sometimes even leather that comes from dogs, products made in China. And the whole pet food controversy, right, we can talk about for a long time. So that's part of how the U.S. is implicated in some of the dog problems in China. But we are also adopting dogs. We are developing shelters and helping them develop their resources and working to stop some of these policies. So we're involved on both ends of that spectrum. So that's an awful lot of information. And so we're just going to leave you with a few closing thoughts so we have almost 20 minutes for questions. So there's no one right way. We're not telling you that our way is the right way to approach these issues, just that we think it's important to be thinking about animals overseas, about the U.S. Implication, about how we're sharing with you some of the work that we do and the ways in which we do it. But we recognize the importance of structural changes. The role of science we can't overemphasize, whether it's veterinary science or other forensic science. Science is critical in all that we do, and it's very helpful and very well respected in other countries as well. We don't know what's the right way to do anything. We try to remind ourselves and our students of that, so we come up with a strategy, and we'll do our best to make it work, but other people have other strategies, and so trying to work together with everyone, not incorporating some of the internecine fighting that we have in the U.S. between community groups as we do that work abroad is a good idea. And so we look for ways to do that with harmony and cooperation, and looking for things that we can do as individuals, because that's actually really helpful for our students. We know we've given you a lot of really sad information. And if you can tell someone, this is one thing you can do, right? You can stop buying this, or you can, it helps, right? And people can make that choice if they want to. And then they can also spend time working on the more structural issues. Thank you very much.
Okay, we have a little less than 20 minutes for questions.
So this could definitely be wrong, so please correct me if these generalizations aren't correct. But it seems as though, while it's very similar, that there's not a lot of animal law in place in either Kenya or China, the situations beyond that are quite different, in that in China it seems like there's a lot of elitism that is tied in, and in Kenya it seems to be more of literally just surviving off of, like, utilizing the animals. And so if that is true, how do you think we as individuals and as, like, a whole movement can combat both of those things and both of those different issues at the same time, or at least in a way that is effective overall in both countries?
Well, I would at least start by saying it depends on whether you're talking about elephants or dogs in both of those countries, because it does operate a little bit differently for those two different species and other species. So there's elitism in both countries, and there's corruption in both countries, and there's sort of structural support for the things that we think are problems in both countries, right? So there are the factories for the ivory, but there's also government support for ivory, basically, in some ways, right, in Kenya as well. It does work differently, right? So you're right about that, but there is some of that in each of those issues in each of those countries. But it is really important to be attentive to the distinctions. So on the ground, we're trying to figure out, and it's different community to community, right? So in Kenya, the relationship people have with dogs, for instance, or with elephants, is different in this tribal community versus in Nairobi versus in this other tribal community. And so that's part of the conversation that we end up having. So when we're having this conversation about this animal in this geographic region, what are the things we need to know? And so trying to be sensitive to learn about that. And so we do need to generalize in some respects when we're talking about legal change, but then we have to kind of go back down. So we learn about the differences and try and make sure we're having conversations that fit generally for society. And we do the same thing in the U.S., right? So we tend to oversimplify our own communities and make, you know, statements that don't actually fit everybody very well here. So that's kind of a general response. I don't know if that's helpful.
First, this is just great work that the center's doing. I'm really excited to see that you guys are doing this. So that's terrific. I'm going to be annoying and ask two questions. I'll try to do it really quickly. One is with respect to the judges that you interacted with in Kenya. I'm with the Environmental Law Institute, which has done a lot of judicial training in Africa over the years. And I know we've always found institutional judges to be very receptive, which I think initially was a surprise to both the notion of an environmental ethic and to the tools that were available. And you can actually, if you're lucky, you sort of trace some of these things through opinions in the future anecdotally, or at least try to see evidence that they're picking these things up. And you touched on this before, but I'm just wondering if you can say more about the reception you got on the animal law side to the idea of maybe an ethic and to what those tools are. And then the other question I think is just an easy one. I'm wondering if you had any sense that the consumption issue in China with respect to ivory could be changing generationally. Is that one of those things where there's like a hope for the future that it's, you know, the younger people are seeing?
So starting with that one first, and then Natasha can weigh in as well. I think I tend to try to look to be hopeful just because I'm so depressing. There's both, right? So part of the problem, part of the reason the elephants are dying is because of the affluence of China. Right, so the generational changes in consumption patterns and in a connection still to the traditional status symbols, right? And ivory is that traditional status symbol in China. So the availability of the money, the desire to maintain that traditional sort of perspective in their homes is killing them. And at the same time, I actually think once the Chinese people, the younger generation, understand that it's killing them, then we have much more opportunity to change. And so it's both, unfortunately, and I don't know when we'll get to a tipping point for sure, but I think it makes me hopeful that people are having these conversations. These are not conversations that would have been had by Chinese people to Chinese people 10 years ago. And so that makes me super hopeful about that.
And I agree with her. I've read so much about it that it's even if the younger generation is changing and they are learning, but again, the people who are buying the stockpiling this ivory, what I've read about what's available in China is they have more than enough. They don't need to get any more in their factories. They have ivory left over that they're not using in their government, the ones where it's supposed to be legal, their government factories. So with Chinese businessmen signing on to an agreement that they're not going to give it as gifts, as you know, similar to the shark finning that happened, I think there's still, it's organized crime, and you know, we're not equipped to get at that. And they're stockpiling it as an asset that one day there'll be no more and it'll be worth something. So I'm hopeful. And I'm also hopeful with the judiciary. They were very receptive. And whether or not, we'll see how that translates, but they want to still be involved. We have a close relationship with the head of their training institute. And we hope to continue to offer what perspective we can, recognizing that it needs to come from within Kenya, just like it needs to come from within China. And it seems that it's happening. It's happening now.
And I would just add really quickly that one of the reasons that our work in Kenya was as successful as it is, even just in its early stages, is because of work of ELI and other good NGOs, right, that have come in to do some of this training. So there's a structure that's set. It was interesting. So pretty much everyone we met was very polite, and they kind of waited to see what we were about for two reasons, right? They're like, okay, are you going to be those kind of Americans? Right, who kind of come in and tell us blah blah blah, right? Or you'd be the helpful kind of American. So on that scale, they were trying to check us out. And then on the other scale, it was like, are you going to be crazy animal people, right? And so I felt the conversations to me felt super familiar to the ones I've had here, especially 20 years ago. And so part of the conversation we had was, okay, so we can talk about animal law as a framework, and people can get really interested in that intellectually and theoretically, and that's like, Okay, we're beginning to see that this is a way to look at some of our problems and to structurally approach those problems. But that's still a little, you know, in the sky. So then we could bring it down and say, okay, let's talk about the link. Let's talk about the studies that prove, right, that have been done in the United States and elsewhere, the link between human violence and animal violence. And that was a conversation that captured their imaginations everywhere we went. They were like, ah, right? Because it resonates. There's some kind of natural intuition that we have that violence is violence, and people who act violent in one context will act in another context. And then talking to them about how we use that as a tool for people who didn't care about it, like police officers, prosecutors, and judges. And that really resonated. The more we talked about animal law as animal law, the more people were like, right? We're not exactly sure because they have so many other things they're working on. Like, this is not something they have time or energy for. And just like it evolved in the United States in some respects, they see it as a part, many of them see it as a part of the environmental conversation. And that makes really good sense. And so we had different kinds of conversations with different people, but everybody, and it's still, we have these conversations when we travel abroad or travel, even in the US, people who aren't familiar with animal law, it's like a light bulb goes off and people are, they're like, wow, this is a concept. And this is something I have sort of personal feeling about that I didn't even know existed. So we had those same kind of initial reactions, which was great.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm trying to understand the dog situation to a greater degree in China. Is the dog the gateway animal from our perspective or from their perspective or both? I mean, certainly it would be from our perspective, but is it also from their perspective? I mean, you know, if let's say there were an animal cruelty law, a national animal cruelty law established in China, and I guess I'd like to know about the momentum for that, would dogs fall under it the way they would here, or would they be considered part of, you know, what's being done considered routine husbandry practices, you know? And we'd be considered livestock there. I'm not sure I understand their role, position.
And I was the one who called them a gateway animal, only because in the U.S. that's usually how you can relate to someone else who has a dog, and they see animals have, you know, they can suffer, and it's an easy link to make for people. And with the ownership of dogs in China on the rise, and the public outcry of how these dogs are being, whether or not you think it's culturally appropriate to allow them to be used for meat, they're still transported in a way that's cruel, they're killed in a way that's cruel, and people, the public in China doesn't like that because now they have a culture of pet ownership. They have way pampered their creatures in ways that in the U.S. doesn't happen, and to an extreme, the elite of China. And so it can shift things because now there's all of these animal welfare organizations that have popped up because of how certain segments of the government and Chinese are treating dogs. So that's why. For them, maybe it will be a gateway animal into getting a better, getting any animal cruelty law in China.
So I think for sure the dogs would be covered under the anti-cruelty, but not all dogs. Just as in the U.S., you can have a cow that's a pet and might be protected, but the cow that's bred for meat won't be. And that will be the same thing in China. So the dogs that are raised for meat will be excluded from that for sure. Right? But that dissonance is an opportunity, right? So we don't have so many cows as pets in the United States, which is why I think it's difficult for people to see them in the way that they see their dogs. So that actually makes me hopeful that we can have that conversation even faster in China once the conversation starts to happen. But trying to get regulation around any of it right now is going to be the difficulty. So I think it potentially opens the door in a lot of ways, so that makes us hopeful. But it remains to be seen, right? And so the people who are making the rules are not of the generation who are now sort of owning, the newer people, right, the younger people who are owning the animals as much. And so we still have this generational disconnect in how we approach it, and how they approach it. So we'll see.
I have a question for Kathy about Kenya. You said that you were aware that some education is going on in the middle schools around animal welfare. Is that, who's doing that? Is it IFA or is it groups like that?
It's ANA, the African Network for Animal Welfare. And okay. So they've developed a curriculum and they're trying to get it in as many of the schools as possible. It's just started this initiative. They had an initiative that started a couple years ago where they would go in and lecture to the kids and have the kids write letters and draw pictures about the animals and sort of explore their relationship to wildlife in particular, and why they valued it. And that was going really well, but they only have one educator who is going school to school to school. And so they've actually developed now a curriculum just over the summer. And so the curriculum got approved, which is awesome, and so now they're going to try to get it to have the teachers trained and be teaching this curriculum across, which is stunning, right? Because this is now part of the national curriculum. So if it's implemented, who knows how that will go, but if it's implemented, it could be in every school at a certain level across the entire nation relatively soon.
Do the kids get out into, because I know some people that run an orphanage in Kenya, and they say that a lot of the more remote villages, the kids never even go more than 2 miles away. So they live, you know, they might live near some national park, but never see it.
That's exactly right. And so the for the communities situated near the parks and conservancies, there's more of that effort to fund those schools and to include the kids and bring them into the facilities. There's also one of the places we went to visit, Opejeta. They let local people graze their farm animals, right? And we're not talking herds and herds. We're talking like, you know, 20 sheep or, you know, 10 cows. But it's kind of weird. It makes us a little like, we're not sure that's a great idea. On the conservancy property, it's like, and by the way, there are lions and stuff. But okay. But it actually works, right? Because it gives the community a stake in maintaining that as sort of open land, right? And if they see they get a benefit of that open land, and then the lodge at the conservancy buys the meat from the community members to serve to the tourists, right? So trying to keep these sort of cycles and circles intertwined so people are really reliant on the success of those enterprises is what's happening. And so there's one entire school funded just outside of Opejeta by Opejeta. And so people are, and then trying to, yeah, get the kids onto the property and see these elephants that they don't actually need to get to see otherwise, yeah.
I was just wondering, you mentioned that there isn't sport hunting in Kenya. So if a foreign hunter wants to go big game hunting, where do they go?
South Africa, Botswana.
So they can go there and kill elephants.
Roughly 23 other countries in Africa that allow it.
That have elephants and that aren't protected.
And unfortunately, even though there is no sport hunting officially, they're still killing. And so when the Kenyan Wildlife Service needs to cull an elephant, right? So if an elephant has had a human animal conflict and they've designated it for killing, they can actually authorize someone else to do that killing. So it kind of ends up being doing the hunting. And that happens more often than we'd like, obviously. But there's still, it's nice to have a country that says it's illegal.
So Kathy and Natasha, this is for both of you. Looking at it from, I just recently graduated with a degree in Bachelor's in Environmental Studies, and so I'm kind of trying to marry the environmental side, not even law, but just in a more broad context with animal advocacy. How important do you think in both China and in Kenya, looking at, even though the economic, political, social, all those realms are meshed together, how important do you think psychologically and culturally looking at both of these countries and how they look at animal welfare, how important do you think that's going to be going forward into this generation?
I think it's important. I think that how people view wilderness and how they view, in Kenya in particular, there are different even concepts of property, right? So there's property in the Western concept in the cities that there's a piece of land I can buy it, I get title, I can exclude others, I can build on it. In the communities, a lot of the land is still held tribally, right? And that means I have to ask the tribal elder for permission to build, and then I sort of own my house or my building, but I don't own the land. And so even those kind of concepts are different place to place, but there is such an attachment in Kenya to the land, right? This cultural patrimony of what it means to be Maasai and to be able to travel, right, or to own, you know, certain animals, or to, so their relationship with the land in Kenya, I find really, really powerful. And as Natasha said, they have really different relationships with animals. They have daily interaction with animals, different animals in different ways. So if we can have that conversation broadened a little, and then have welfare and other protection sort of aspects added, I think it's pretty exciting to think about what can happen in Kenya. And the Kenyan government has also recognized how important that patrimony is, whether or not they care about elephants or the trees. And there's foresting issues, there's other kinds of problems in Kenya with wilderness right now as well. So I think there's a lot there. In China, you have this, because of the Cultural Revolution and because of some of the political history there, in the recent history, right, you have this detachment from the wild, detachment, right, and the importance of living in cities and creating these new realities of human existence. And so I think that's going to take longer Having said that, there is still these deep traditions, right, these deep connections. Dogs are not the most widely owned animals. It's birds and fish, right? And that's a deep Chinese tradition. And they're handled differently, right? And if we can then talk about handling them even differently than they are handled, but there is a sort of reverence and respect. So if we can make these connections and build the bridges, but it's going to take time, it's going to take attention, and more in China than in Kenya, I think.
Okay, we're all out of time for questions. Thank you all for coming.